all of you. And this morning we are going to talk about certifications. We all know that this green transition has been going on for some time, and this is something that is a very important issue for many Danish companies. And in Denmark we use certain types of certifications, and today we will look into what kind of certification do we mostly use in Denmark. And we have a panel here of three companies also talking about which certification they use and how they use it and why they use it. And also we will look into a little bit more about the users, the end users. How do they perceive these certification? Is it transparent for them? What certification is out there? And how are they different from each other? And the last question we will ask the panel is about the future. How do they see the future for the certifications and also for the company who's using the certifications? How do they actually encourage themselves and the certification to adopt new issues? But first I would like to introduce the panel here today. From our my furthest right, for your furthest left, is Nille Skals, and she is from the B Corporation. And next to her is Jesper Panduro from Skagerrak.
Yeah, Skagerrak.
And then next, number three in the road, is Lone Dittmar from Wilton. And then we have Annette Hastrup from Cradle to Cradle. And the next we have here is Ingrid Elmedal from Ecolabel. And last but not least is Ole Kiel from FDB Furniture. Good, we will start with Nille. Will you start to talk? Tell us all about the B Corporation. What is the certification all about? And what is it you offer the companies who is signing up with you?
Yes, thank you. That's a huge question. I think I'm not going to start with the certification because B Corp or B Corporation is more than just a certification. It's actually a movement. And it's actually a movement of business leaders on a mission to accelerate a transition to a regenerative economy. And when you're on a mission like that, it sounds really huge and big. You have to redefine what is the role we are playing as businesses in society. You have to start sort of questioning, what kind of business is it that I have created and what do I want to use it for? And that's touching the design criteria of a business. Why is it in business? Who is it there for? What's the fiduciary duty? Who are we serving? And how are we in business? So when you start from that perspective, it becomes much more than just a certification. You need a standard, you need design criteria, you have to sort of validate that you are this type of business. But it is actually a mindset and a way of thinking about being in business. So with that starting point, I think the most important thing to take away from what is B Corp and what is a B Corp certification, it is thinking about the why I am in business and how I use my business to ensure that we are on a transition to a regenerative economy. And that means you have to be good business for everyone. And good, then it becomes normative. What is good and what are design criteria for good? Some of you are designers. You know that if you design for cheap, you get something cheap. If you design for long lasting, you get something different. And when you ask that question, then you have to start looking at, how am I good for my employees? Have I designed good operational systems for my employees? What about the local environment I'm a part of? What about the climate, the environment? What about my governance structure? What about what I'm delivering for the customer? So you're looking in a 360 perspective on your business. And you can look at that in the perspective of a certification from operational practices or your everyday procedures, or you can look at that from your impact business model. Are you using the core of your business to create value for the world? And I think that's the main shift. If we are moving to a regenerative economy, you have to start asking as a business, am I here to extract the most possible financial value from the business, or am I here to find out how I build value for society into every single aspect of my business model?
Very good. We will get to that later, and we will move on to the next certification, which is the Cradle to Cradle. Annette, will you give you a little pitch?
So as I said, it's a very holistic certification, and it's also a pathway to continuous improvement, because we have various certification levels from bronze, silver, gold to platinum. So we evaluate the products and materials within each of these categories, so you might achieve different levels within each of the categories, but the overall certification level will equal the lowest. And then you have to recertify your products every second year and demonstrate improvements. So in that way, it becomes a pathway to the positive. It's also a very good tool if you want to demonstrate progress towards the UN global goals.
I think Lone will tell us why they have chosen, Milton have chosen the Cradle to Cradle and why, how they're using it in their daily business.
Yeah. We chose Cradle to Cradle primarily because of the international perspective, because our business is based on 99% exports. So we had to have a label that was well known outside Denmark as well. Then we also believe that Cradle to Cradle is one of the most holistic approaches to sustainability with the five categories of certification. Honestly, we actually believed to begin with that Cradle to Cradle was only for large companies. That as a medium-sized company, we were not able to do this. We do not have the resources. We do not have this great CSR department. But we got to know Annette and her team, and we realized actually we were already very well on the way. We are producing in Denmark. So in regards to social fairness and in regards to controlling the whole production process, we are really well on the way. But of course, Cradle to Cradle is a philosophy as well, just like you said with B Corp. So it's changing your mindset in the way you do business. So it's not only about circularity, it's also really a lot about circularity. But it's also about looking into the material health of your product. If you use bad materials like PVC or some other banned materials, you shouldn't bring it on into a circular economy. So actually you have to have another starting point. So what Cradle to Cradle does is mapping where you are, and then, as Annette said, you have to improve and progress. So for us, actually, Cradle to Cradle is much more than just a certification. Mm-hmm. It's our tool for the sustainable business development.
But how has it helped you in business, for example? Have you had customers actually saying, oh, this is great, we've just been waiting for certified carpets like yours?
Yes and no. Designers and architects are very much into sustainability and very much, they really want to make the right choice, but it's difficult because it's really, it's not black or white, it's more like 50 shades of gray when you're in this. On the other hand, we have the purchases. We do carpets for cruise ships and hotels, so it's huge amounts of carpets. So every euro cent counts. So it's also for them about price. But if we can push this agenda with the designers and architects who really want to make the right choice, it's a good way to go. But of course, as I said, Cradle to Cradle is recognized, well known, but it's more on a level where we heard about it, we know it's about circular economy, but we don't really know what is in it. And in this sense, we got to have really good conversations one-to-one with our customers, kind of educating them what this means to our business, how we see this. So we really got to add value in the conversations with our customers and partners.
But what do you think? Now I'm also asking to Jesper before I get to you, because this seems like it's a lot of work. Do you have one person full-time dedicated to this in your organizations, or how does it work?
No. I think if you do that, you do it wrong. I think it has to be part of the thinking and daily operation in your business.
So it's actually already incorporated?
At the beginning, it's okay. It's a tool because you have to learn it. But after it has been a tool, it has to be a kind of value in your mindset.
Okay.
If you don't, I think it's too difficult to handle.
Sure. Luna, what do
you say? That's the same. You can't have sustainability in one department. It has to be your core business. So I also had colleagues coming to me and pointing out difficulties. We can't do this because this is not the way we should do it. So it's really changing the mindset overall in the organization.
Okay, then I look forward to hear about the Ecolabel. You have two certifications under your wings.
Yeah.
And of course, they are very well known here in the Nordic, and the flower, EU flower, is of course big in EU. Could you please tell us a little bit about what it's all about?
Yes.
Thank you.
I come from Ecolabeling Denmark. And as you said, Bettina, we are working with two eco-labels here in Denmark, two official eco-labels. The first one is the Nordic Swan eco-label, which I suppose most of you know. It's in fact 93% of the Danes which knows about the Nordic eco-label. And this label was developed 30 years ago, so we have a lot of experience working with eco-labels. And the EU Ecolabel is the EU Commission Ecolabel, which started also almost 30 years ago. It was in 1992. The overall goal with these two Ecolabels it is to reduce the overall environmental impact from production and consumption, and it's both on products and also on services. So you will have a product-specific criteria documents, which goes in for furnitures as an example. Then we set in specific criterias minded for furniture production. To ensure the maximum environmental impact, then both the label that set, as I said, the specific requirements, and we evaluate these requirements every 4 to 5 years. In that way, we push the market and the producers to be more and more environmentally friendly. The labels, they are very powerful tools for the producers to use them in their development of the products, but also it is a very powerful tool for consumers. So when they go out to do the shops, it can be in the grocery stores, but also as we see more and more right now in furnitures, then you know, you can recognize the labels on the products, and in that way you know that you buy an environmentally friendly product.
And when I see what's happening, how fast it's going with this green transition and the speed of new things, say that you change every 4 years?
Four, fifth year.
Criteria. Is it sufficient enough, do you think? Or?
maybe for some it is, but you must also see it out from the producer's perspective. Every time that we do this revision, you need to go the whole product life cycle. And the thing which makes both the Nordic Swan Ecolabel and the EU Ecolabel special compared to other labels is that we go in and set demands in all product life cycles. So we look at all the raw materials, we look at the production side, we look also put in good quality, so it's from the consumer perspective, and also in the waste. So for all these four phases, we will need to go in and set demands.
Thank you. Ole, now you are a user of the Ecolabel,
yes.
Your company is,
yes.
I know that you also, you were nodding when I said, do you need to update? But please let us know.
It's just one product.
Yeah, I know, yeah. I know. But it's good to create a little bit of a distance. No. could you tell us, FDB Furniture, why did you choose to use certification? Why is there a need for you to have this certification?
I have to start another a little back, because we actually own by 1.8 million Danes, so we have to act good in the society in Denmark or in the world. So that's why we think. So when we started with the FDB Furnitures again in 2012-13, it was just natural, because we also a member of we owned by Coop, who was owned by those members. So in the beginning I think the way we think is to be responsible in everything we do. So from the beginning, everything we did was FSC, all textiles, Ecotex, and so on. And I think then now we have to build on the Swan. We should actually have done that from the beginning, but I don't think we was able to do that. But we think that the Swan is a very good, and we hope that the customers also will demand it in a certain time. Today, no one does, but we hope it will come.
Oh, that's a very good keyword for me.
Yeah. But we hope it will come, and we are working with the Swan. We have 5 products now with the Swan or something like that, and I think during the next year we will change nearly half of our assortment to the Swan. So when we're working also with the factories, we're going out to find new factories. It's like Camilla calls it a bean spin, because it's very difficult to find producers who can actually produce to the swan. Our biggest issue is actually when we paint, we have to paint with water.
Based,
yes. Mm-hmm. And the drying time on the factory is four times as long and when you use other materials. And they don't have the space actually to do that. They don't have the capacity to do that. But every time we meet a factory, we will ask them that that should be possible during half a year, 1 year, 1.5 years. So our ambition actually, because we believe the swan is very good for the environment and also the way we think, and we hope that the Danes, the 1.8 million, will demand it also for buying. But so that's actually how we think in all we do, because that's our DNA.
But yeah. I think that's really a couple of points I want to ask everyone, because it seems for me certification is a lot of work. It's a lot of details, and it's of course a way when you work with the green transition, you have to somehow verify what is it you're doing. Is there any way we can get some help to make it publicly known what criteria, what goals do we have and what do we work towards?
I think it will be worth it.
Yeah.
Because it's like, of course it takes a lot of work in the beginning, then you get used to it and the your factories get used to it, so it gets easier and easier to do it. But I think it's like when Irma in 1986 sold the first carrots in Ecologic. They rotten up in the shop because no one wants to buy them.
Irma is a big, large
supermarket chain in Copenhagen. But today they have like 40% of their turnover in Ecologic products. So I think we just have to work with it. I think it will take 10, 15, 20 years because it's the people who's growing up now. It's you know the people who is between 10 and 25 maybe now who's in the future will buy the products.
We can't change us.
I don't buy so much Ecologic, but we have to work with it in a long time, and also like I think it's like you can look at like the Ecologic products, and it have taken 30 years or 35 years to get up on that level.
Yes, I believe it will be ticket to play, just like our fire certificates are today. Of course, we are very happy to help push the agenda, and I really believe we are. But we can't do this by ourselves. We're a medium-sized company based in Denmark. So, but I think the changing the mindset overall will help really push the agenda. And as you said, the young generation, I have children, they cook at school without meat. If I was a meat factory, I would kind of consider what will happen when they start cooking themselves. So it's a direction, and I think we just have to embrace it and then be front runners instead of waiting for regulations.
The motivation is the responsibility. And I think if you start out using a certification to have a competitive advantage, I think it's wrong. Because you have, in my opinion, the wrong driver and the wrong motivation. So I think you should do it because you believe in it. And then over time, and also accept that you're in a niche. We now talked about organic food. There's still a split between conventional food and organic food. So will it ever be 100% organic? Maybe, maybe not. You don't know. So I think here, know that you're in a niche. Do it from your heart, because that's what you believe in. Mm. And I think those two things, if you combine them with the niche, somebody will look for something that has a low price, maybe cheap. Others will look for something that will last a lifetime. The certificate for us is a way to help us build our values and tools into a daily operation. We don't do it to be able to say, we are B Corp, you're not. I hope that many more in my industry will be B Corp, because I think it's better for the planet. So I think in the long run, it's not about my business, it's about the planet.
I think one of the main questions, and which are also the questions that the three business leaders here are stressing, is we have a responsibility of intergenerational equity. We have to figure out how do we, if we go back to what is sustainability in the
in the original definition of Core Harlem Bundland is about living our lives today without taking away or harming future generations' possibilities of living their lives. And when we are there, then it's a huge responsibility on the shoulders of the business leaders, and we need to be there to help them. And essentially, our certifications or brands are guidelines and helps in making choices and deciding things, because you're still going to be doing, I mean, go this way or that way, and we don't really know. There are loads of things we don't know on that. And I think that the main shift in should consumers choose someone because of a certification? I don't think so. They should choose businesses that they believe in, and certifications might be a little bit of that, but it's only a tiny bit of who you are. You can have a certification and still have a lot of other things you have to deal with. I think it's a question of ethics. It's a question of a new normal. It's a question of having that dialogue with everyone out there, with the designers, with the investors. We haven't even talked about the investors, which I think is the main element. One thing is what we buy, and can we, there are, I don't know, 600 different brands we can choose from in terms of certifications and all kinds of stuff. We're never going to understand that, even with the best of communication. We have to have the dialogue about what kind of business do we want, and how does that look in the product, how does that look in the process, how does that look in the ethics and the philosophy and the whole element. And it's a big discussion, and we can't put that on businesses alone, we can't put that on the brands.
No, but it's nice to be, you know, wanting to save the world, be holistic, but when you look at
it... But I don't think it's a question about saving the world. I think it's a question about being a business leader who can tell your kids or your grandchildren or that I am actually not bad. I mean, I've been in business forever. I've been a business consultant forever, and saying I'm a management consultant, that wasn't really sort of, way, that's great. But it doesn't mean that business is bad. And I think we're redefining that role of business in society in different ways. You've been redefining that by how you are founded, the way that you're owned. You're redefining that because you're a owner who wants to do something different with your business. You're redefining it. That's the discussion that we're having. And that we need to have that with the consumers, because the consumers is not, you say users. I like to call us citizens.
But what do you do to explain that to the consumers?
What do we do? Well, most of all, we help build businesses who are that and who raise that voice. And some of them are activistic enough to stand here and say, "Hey, I'm not sustainable. I'm a responsible company, but there's so much more that I need to be doing." Being transparent on that, I think that's the most we can do. Raise the dialogue, have the conversations, invite people in, and continuously think. None of us are sustainable. We're responsible, but sustainable, it doesn't exist.
I agree with Nille, but I think certification is also about credibility, because sustainability, climate change, etc., is very high on the agenda, and nowadays all companies would claim that they are sustainable. So I think it's important that you have this third-party verified certification. And I agree there's a lot of different certification, but if you have a label which is recognized, then it is at least a sign of that you
serious
have
about it,
had somebody to verify what you're doing.
And how do you see, for example, I know some furniture companies that I've been talking to, and they are have the sworn certification, and they say it's really good, it's very nice for the Nordic market. But when we move to the US market or Asian market, we have to have other kind of certification that's kind of used in their markets. Yeah. And they have actually maybe one or two people who's actually sitting and working with these certifications. Are you doing any collaboration with any of the overseas certifications? So maybe, in fact, if you have the Sworn or the EU Flower, you're already on the way. You don't have to do all the way from the bottom up.
There could be a little bit more work doing in the communication outside the Nordics, but for both the Nordics One Ecolabel and the EU Ecolabel, they are what we call Type 1 Ecolabels. And there are a whole organization, a global organization called Global Ecolabeling Network, working with these Type 1 Ecolabels. And in this network, they work together in going out and tell about the what's called the baselines in the criteria.
Okay, thank you very much. I think we have just one more question, and then we will open up for questions, because this is fine and it all looks good, and we have still work to do. But what about the future? This green transition, the goals of the companies, more and more is on the movement. I know, Nille, you've been very busy. We have lots of companies who are interested in being a part of a movement, but also to use the certification, as you say, for some kind of verification and to set goals. where are we now, where we want to be, and where do we have issues we have to work with. But how do you see the future? When we're standing here in 5 years' time, I invite you again in 5 years' time. Where do you see you are as a certification and as a user of the certification?
5 years is a short time when you're building a movement. We started 5 years ago here in the Nordics, and you can start seeing that a little bit of that movement is running. My ambition is not certifying every single company in the Nordics. My ambition is radically redefining the design criteria for business. Certification is just a way of proving that it's actually possible to do so. For me, it's much more a question of moving the fiduciary duty of the businesses. Why are we in business? Who are we there for? And who are we accountable to? So that's what I'm seeing now much more. And that means that we also have to educate the other sectors around us. So for me, in 5 years, we will be a movement, but much more with imperatives for what is a new economy.
Is it something you're building in B Corp? It's something in an area you're focused on now?
And you're going to see globally that in 2 weeks' time, it's the anniversary of Milton Friedman's very important article. If any one of you went to business school, then 50 years ago, he published The Business of Business is creating profits for shareholders. And that's now that we're seeing, okay, it took 50 years before we start to sort of erase that again from the mindset of all the nice young women and men coming from the business school. So this is the moment of what are the imperatives for the 21st century. So we're moving up.
Yeah, yes, but do you have anything from your point of view, for your company's point of view, that you say, well, we think this movement, this changes that they are doing in B Corp, this is exactly our vision?
I think, I very much agree with Nille on the development of the movement, and especially the key word to me here is movement. At the beginning, we were not that many, but now we are more. And I can see when we join up in the community, we actually help each other. And I think that's
so it's like a network building.
It's networking, but with like-minded people. And you talk about not what is wrong with others, but you talk about how can you actually do impact. And I like that a lot. And I hope that will continue. And as I see what Nille has been doing the past years, we are definitely on that way, so I like it a lot. And the other thing I like is, with the whole standard, it's developing. So if this was the right level, there might be changes in the society, so next year you have to go here to have the same score, and I like that a lot, because
always improving.
It's competing in a new way. You're
competing with yourself, so you measure and you compete with yourself. And
Annette, anything in the pipeline coming up from Crate to Crate?
I must say that we are experiencing an increasing interest and an increasing number of companies getting certified against the Crate to Crate certified standard. And I'm also happy to say that we are now soon launching this version 4, which the Crate to Crate Products Innovation Institute, who administers the standard, has been working on for several years, along with a lot of stakeholders. Also, been a possibility for the public to comment on it, and it will be launched later this year.
Can you lift a little bit on what is going to be the new version? Is there any areas?
It is built on the new science and best practice, and we are addressing some of these the current issues like climate change, polluting, polluted air, soil, and water, etc. And of course, the circular economy. So it's becoming. It's always been designed for products for the circular economy, but it's getting even stronger now. So we have the very newest criteria. So we are very excited to get more products certified against this standard.
So is it just for new products or the ones?
No, this is also, as I said, this is a path to positive, as we say. You can develop, you can use it as a design guide, because Cradle to Cradle is both a philosophy a vision, a design philosophy, and this quality standard.
I think if we look into the future, I think actually we are sitting here in Copenhagen. Hvad hedder forkælet på engelsk?
Spoiled.
We are spoiled, actually. We are the 2% richest people in the world. So I think if we look 5 years, of course we will work with the Ecolabel, we will work with a lot of things. But I also think we have to work where we produce, how does they get energy? How does they live? We use a lot of factories we can't produce on because they are not BSCI certified and everything. So I think that's the trend that we have to look into the world, because if everyone in the world was like us, using all what we used, then Greenland was not there anymore. There was just earth and we had water here. So we have to think not just to look at our small country, because we can do a lot of things, so we have to look wherever we produce, how do they produce, and how do they get energy, and how do they live, and so on. So that's I think we're talking a lot of more about that in 5 years ahead, because when people around the world is getting to our standard, we have to find energy in another way. So and maybe transportation in another way, and everything. So I think that the mindset has been changed already in 5 years, actually. And we all have to work fast on
that. So we are spoiled kids with a lot of responsibility. Now yeah. I would like to...
I normally ask people who says, I'm very responsible. I ask them, and I can ask you, where is your clothes produced? You have no idea, and you know, don't know if it's in Bangladesh with child labor or whatever it is. No one knows, even how much they work with this.
That's why I like to work with the furniture industry. It's easier.